Welcome back. This is Miss Kennedy. I'm going to be talking about ecosystem ecology today, which is basically the movement of energy in ecosystems. I'm a little sick, so my voice might sound a little bit funny, so I do apologize. So I want to start off a little bit different because I feel like I was a little bit dry in my last few lectures, which is just not me. So I actually want to start with a song so you guys can kind of get to know me and the music that I listen to. We're only going to listen to like 20 seconds and the audio's not that good, but I'm currently listening to a lot of 21 Savage, and I really like this song. It's called A Lot, so just enjoy before we get started.
Turn my headphone down a little bit. How much money you got? 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 A lot. How much money you got? A lot. How many problems you got? A lot. How many people done doubted? A lot. Left you out.
Yeah, so that's what I like to listen to right now. I have a lot of students. I have a lot of problems. I wish I had a lot of money. Okay. Anyway, so we're gonna get started on this lecture. Some chemical formulas that you should just preview and get familiar with. There's really not that many in this lecture. Sorry, but just so that you know that. Ooh, my goodness. Just so that you are aware. That is one really important one that you might not have seen in a while. C6H12O6, which is the chemical formula for glucose, which is also just a form of sugar, and that's going to be really important today. We have H2O, which you should know, and we have CO2, which is carbon dioxide. So just feel comfortable with those three. When we study ecosystems, there's two kind of things that scientists have realized about them. And the first is that ecosystem boundaries are kind of hard to define. They're not really what we imagine them to be, which are these clear, straight lines. They're a little bit more complicated than that. So I'll explain in 1 minute. So if you take a look at this picture over here, we have Yellowstone National Park. And when scientists study Yellowstone, they really just looked within the park at the animals and the plants that live there. And then they realized that some animals and some, you know, insects were actually leaving the park and going to outer areas. So they kind of had to broaden their scope. Instead of just looking at Yellowstone National Park as one ecosystem, they had to really add tons of acres into that ecosystem so they could study it better. So what once was just this kind of simple, tiny area, as an ecosystem, has grown into a lot larger of an ecosystem. So they're hard to define, the boundaries, meaning the outside areas of the ecosystem. And they can change based on, you know, new inputs and outputs into that environment. Another really important thing to note is that ecosystems can be large or small. We have these massive ecosystems like the Yellowstone area, which you're seeing here, but then you can also have a very simple ecosystem within a tree, within a puddle, in a pond. That can count as an ecosystem because there's living things, there's energy moving in and out. So ecosystems aren't just one large area like the rainforest, the Amazon rainforest. It can be more complicated than that and more small than that. So keep those things in mind. One key vocab word is biosphere. When we study life on Earth, we're really looking at the biosphere, which is also really just all living areas on Earth. So it's the region of our planet. Sorry about my handwriting, as usual. The region of our planet where life is. The textbook will use, I'm sorry. Oh my goodness, this is a rough start to this. Where life resides, which basically just means where there is life. Okay? And it's all ecosystems combined are the biosphere. So that's just some nice vocab to keep in mind. Again, biosphere is all ecosystems on Earth, all regions where there's life, from the water to the trees to the sand. So when we study the biosphere, we're really studying how energy moves throughout all living things. Because again, we care about energy, we care because it provides us with our lives, so we want to see how it moves throughout our ecosystems. So really, all energy on Earth kind of logically starts with the sun. We can't have energy without the sun. And that's why we're a planet that revolves around the sun. So we take the sun, not us, but some organisms will take sun's energy, and through a hopefully familiar process called photosynthesis, certain plants will take sun's energy and turn it into usable energy. So photosynthesis is that first kind of step in taking and making excuse me, in making available energy on Earth. So it's really just taking sun, a little bit of water, and some carbon dioxide, and you turn it into sugar. Remember I said you're going to need to know that sugar formula? Well, here's why. And it also produces a little bit of oxygen, which is awesome. So this process is incredibly important to life on Earth because it's making this sugar available to other organisms. But it's also, if you look here, has this really important exchange where it takes, plants will take in carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and create oxygen. So that's where we get our breathable oxygen. And that's why people care so much about plants and planting trees, is that they can take in some of the carbon dioxide we're adding to our atmosphere. So it's a really good way to kind of combat climate change is plants. They're doing it naturally. It's really the first way we access energy. The sun will be absorbed by plants, turned into usable sugars, usable energy. And that's normally done by the plants we see on our walk to school, by algae in the ocean, and some bacteria. And we call those things producers because they produce our energy. And the next process that moves energy is a process that not only plants do, we also do it as well. It's called cellular respiration. And it takes that sugar that's been made, so the C6H12O6, and turns it into actual energy. Not just sun energy, but energy that our bodies can use, our cells can use. So it's a really important process. If you look here, you can see the equation for it. I'm not going to get too much into it, but it's basically, if you look at it, the reverse of photosynthesis. So carbon dioxide and sugar are taken in, energy... sugar and oxygen are taken in, and energy and carbon dioxide are produced. So there is kind of that exchange where you take that oxygen and that sugar that plants have given you, and you create waste, and you also create energy. So that's cellular respiration, and everybody does cellular respiration. Have our plants, they've done a lot of work to make energy, and then what happens? Well, we really look at that energy flowing in what's called the food chain, and you might remember this from Living Environment. And it's very simple, and there's going to be a lot of vocabulary that comes out of this, but there's going to be a nice kind of vocabulary wrap-up at the end of this, so don't worry if you miss some of the words that I'm saying. But really, our plants will start out with our energy, our producers, okay? And then once producers are grown and ready, primary consumers will come eat them. And it's pretty simple, pretty logical. Primary consumers are normally known as herbivores, because they only eat plants. So Ms. Kennedy's actually an herbivore because I only eat plants for the most part. So you have your producers, you have your plants that get eaten by your herbivores or your primary consumers. And those are things like zooplankton in the ocean. Those are things like zebras, rabbits, mice, all that good stuff. And then your herbivores or your primary consumers are eaten by your carnivores and your omnivores, which are most of you. Those are things like fish and lions and bears and all that good stuff. And then, of course, once the carnivores at the secondary level have gotten energy, some of them will be eaten by what's called a tertiary consumer. And that really is like a third level consumer. In Living Environment, we teach you that is also known as an apex predator, because nothing really eats it. It's at the top of that food chain. It's kind of the king or the queen of the food chain, because really nothing can kill it. Humans are usually the tertiary consumer, the apex predator. Sharks are an apex predator or tertiary consumer, and most birds, a lot of like hunting birds like hawks and eagles, are tertiary consumers because they're kind of the last in that chain. Really nothing eats them. This arrow doesn't go on. So that's a food chain. We really have, if you look at it, we have two food chains here. So we have lion, zebra, and grass. The grass gets eaten by the zebra gets eaten by the lion. Then we have algae, zooplankton, fish, bald eagle. So those are two food chains that we have. Sorry, I'm writing in yellow. My bad. All right, so that's a food chain, very simple. The next thing we have is a food web. So a food web, I just kind of like to think of as complicated food chain. It's many food chains put together to create this web. And that's a kind of key way to remember the two. So food chains are small, very simple, usually just following the flow between a couple organisms. So here we're just studying how the grass moves to the zebra and the lion, and we're not doing anything else. Because we know that grass is eaten by other organisms, but in a chain, you just care about the direction of energy through one simple chain. Food webs, you get to see how energy moves throughout the entire ecosystem, so it's a lot more complicated. You can see it's a little bit more complex than, oh my goodness, it is a little bit more complex than a food chain, because it's many food chains put together. So if we look at this food web and we try and break it down, we can start with our grasses here, and we'll follow the arrows. So the grass gets eaten by a wildebeest, okay? Ignore the fact that it's dead. The arrows are going the opposite direction that you'd think of. Normally you'd think the arrow would point towards what's being eaten, but really it's showing energy is flowing towards the wildebeest, and the wildebeest will get eaten by the lion, because that's one food chain that we have. So the grasses would be our what? Hopefully you said our producers. The wildebeest would be our primary consumer, and the lion would be the secondary consumer as well. But another really important part of this is kind of what happens next. We have the food chain, that, and it really just stops right here. There's no more flow of energy, or that's what you think at first. But what happens once the lion is dead? You know, what's going on there? And what happens when anything dies? Does the energy just die with them? Hopefully you said no, if you actually responded to me. Energy does not just die with an organism when it dies. There's really important organisms on Earth that help to recycle that energy, because hopefully you remember everything gets recycled on Earth. All energy is returned back to its original cycle or to a new one. So those that will take the energy from a food chain once it's done and recycle it are really important. So there's kind of three organisms that are involved in it, in this process, and you've already learned about a couple. So you have your scavengers, and they're kind of the first step in this role. Scavengers are things like vultures and hyenas, and they take dead stuff and they kind of eat it, and they break some of it down. So the hyena here will break down the wildebeest, will eat some of the wildebeest and start this process of breaking down nutrients and energy. After the scavengers have come in, something called a detritivore is next. And a detritivore is usually something like a beetle. And they're really special because they like to eat poop, and they like to eat dead tissue. So they'll start to break down the leftovers from the hyena, or if the hyena dies as well, they'll start to help break down the excess nutrients that are there. And there's so much energy here in the tissue and the poop that still need to be used. So then we have our last little stage here, and it's our decomposers. And they take what the detritivores have broken down, and they make them into tiny, tiny, tiny particles, or they really just get molecules of energy or nutrients, and they return them into the soil. And those are things like bacteria, earthworms, some fungi do it as well. And their role is really important because they take all the stuff that's been broken down by the detritivores and the scavengers, and they actually recycle it. This is really where recycling is happening, is with the decomposers. So they're really important to the ecosystem, but you can't have it without the scavengers and detritivores. They help as well. So if you look back into our food web here, you can see the earthworms are working as a decomposer. So are the bacteria. They're helping to break down the wildebeest. The dung rolling beetle is a detritivore because he's taking some of that poop and that dung, which is poop, and he's helping to recycle it back into the environment. And then our scavengers are our hyena and our vulture. Okay, so hopefully you kind of understand that, and it's a really important part of an ecosystem that has to occur. It has to be recycled. Energy has to be recycled, and it can't happen without the scavengers, detritivores, and decomposers. So hopefully you feel comfortable with those. So ecosystems can be really productive, and sometimes they're not that productive. And we like to actually understand the processes and amounts of energy that are being used up in ecosystems. So scientists have kind of created this system of measurement. And it might seem confusing. This is probably the hardest concept in this lecture, but it's really very simple when you look at it. So the sun gives off lots and lots of energy to the Earth, right? But about 99% of the energy given off by the sun is reflected and kind of bounced back into the atmosphere without being absorbed. So 99% of our energy is not usable. But there is 1% of that energy that finds its way into producers. Okay, so 1% of energy from the sun is captured by producers, which is awesome. But it doesn't even seem, it's kind of crazy if you think about it, because it's really not that much energy. Imagine if producers could capture 50% of the sun's energy, but they don't. And so this 1% that is captured by those producers is actually what's known as gross primary productivity. Which is basically just the amount of solar energy that a producer can capture through the process of photosynthesis. So this 1% of energy from the sun is the gross primary productivity, or GPP, of an ecosystem. Okay, so let's say this ecosystem is the Amazon. The Amazon's gross primary productivity right here is 1%. Which is not that much. But then we take it even further and we see how much of that 1% of energy is actually being used by other organisms. So the plants take up 1% of the energy, which is what you're seeing right here. The plants take up that 1%. 60% of that 1% of energy, so not that much of it, is lost to respiration. So plants use energy and they burn it away, kind of. They let it go into the atmosphere through the process of photosynthesis and respiration. So that's unusable energy. Nobody can use that. I'm sorry. Unusable energy. But 40% of the energy from the gross primary productivity is actually passed on to help producers grow and reproduce. And that right there is the usable energy in an ecosystem. Or the energy that you and I could, you know, go pick up a leaf and eat. So that 40% is actually what's called the net primary productivity. Because that's the actual amount of energy being, you know, used and created by the plants that can then be used for other things. And that's referred to as the NPP. Okay, so the NPP is 40% of that gross primary productivity. So this might seem a little confusing, but a really good way to remember this is, you know, like, pretend you work at, say you work at Burlington Coat Factory, okay? And this is all the money, this picture kind of represents all the money that Burlington makes. So 99% of the money that Burlington makes will go into stupid stuff like, you know, not stupid stuff, but advertising, marketing, buying more clothing, and opening up new stores. This 1% right here is actually your paycheck. That's how much Burlington will pay you. That's the gross primary productivity for yourself, how much money you're getting. But there's lovely things like taxes and all that good stuff that kind of waste some of your money. So the NPP is what you actually make. The money that you put in your pocket is your net primary productivity. Because your paycheck says one thing, but then the actual amount in your bank is another thing. So that's kind of an easy way to understand productivity and how you can measure it. Let me know if you have questions. I really like this graphic. It kind of represents the net primary productivity in a bunch of different ecosystems. Oh my gosh, a bunch of different ecosystems around the world. So take a minute to look at it. And then I have this extra credit question here for you. I want you to look at this image and write a brief explanation in your own words, please, about why the swamps and marshes and the tropical rainforests have that highest NPP of all the ecosystems here. Why do you think that might be that these two ecosystems are doing the most NPP? So really think about that. You can use the internet if you want to help you, but you can type it into your notebook or bring it in on a piece of paper for some extra credit. This will also often evaluate the ecological efficiency of an area, and that's really how much energy is being created and used throughout the entire ecosystem, not just through the plants. So gross primary productivity and net were really just how much energy do the plants have, but now ecological efficiency is how much energy does the entire ecosystem have. So you study this through looking at the biomass, and biomass is just all the living stuff, all living matter in an area. Okay, so let's say this area is the Serengeti or the Sahara Desert. We want to know how efficient energy is in this ecosystem. And we study this, we can actually look at this in something called a trophic pyramid. And trophic levels or pyramids, oh goodness, trophic levels and pyramids seem kind of fancy, but they're very simple. Each different organism is in a different trophic level because they use certain amounts of energy. And they're also in different levels based on what they eat, but trophic levels are all about how much energy they're getting. So if you actually look at our graph here, we start with 10,000 joules of energy from the plants. That's how much energy they've created from the beautiful sun. Okay, and that's great. And they start with 10,000 joules, but then if you look here at the zebras, they only get 1,000 joules. And that's because a lot of energy is lost as you move up a pyramid. And it kind of makes sense, and hopefully you remember from living environment that some energy just lost as heat from the plants. You lose some of it like that. You lose some of it just by existing, by creating more. They're turning sunlight into sugar, which uses a lot of energy. So they lose a lot through just getting to the point where they're able to grow and reproduce. So that not a lot of energy is actually able to pass on. Once it is passed on to the next trophic level, which is the primary consumers, the consumers will actually eat a lot of that energy, and they use that energy to help them grow and reproduce. So they are also using a lot of energy, and some energy is lost as heat because these organisms move, they burp, they fart, and they create a lot of energy, and that's also given off into the environment. So some is lost as heat. And that's important, an important theme that will come up a lot. Okay? And then once that primary consumer is being hunted or whatever, the thing that's hunting it is not going to get that much energy at all. It's only going to get 100 joules of energy when we really started with 10,000 joules. And that's because the same process occurs. This organism here, this lion, is going to use some of that energy to eat, to grow, to survive. And some is lost as heat. And I think it's really interesting to look at. We put these animals at the top of the food chain, like a lion's at the top of the food chain, which is great, but think about how hard it is for a lion to hunt. They have to spend tons of energy running, chasing, climbing, trying to bring down a giraffe or whatever. So they're burning tons of energy, and they only get, maybe a couple pounds of meat out of it, which seems like a lot, but it's really not that much because these animals are burning lots of energy, and they only get very little of it. So they don't get that much energy because they use tons of energy, and the energy they're getting isn't that great. So really, ideally, and this it says it in your textbook as well, the best kind of model is to stick with the zebras, to stay in the area of the primary consumers, because that's where you're getting more energy. If you, as a human, kind of cut out this need to eat the primary consumers, you get a little more energy from it. So I wanted to show one of my favorite videos that kind of illustrates how hard it is for top predators or consumers to get their food. So you're about to watch three cheetahs take down an ostrich. And I want you to think about how hard it is for these cheetahs to do this, how often they need to do it, and how much energy might they actually get out of it, this hunt.
Slower to realize the danger, and the cheetahs switch targets. Effort and weight of all three brothers to bring down this powerful bird. Even now, the ostrich could land a fatal kick.
So you can see how challenging it is, and how many cheetahs need to be involved, how much energy they burned, and how much will they actually get from the ostrich, who's already used a lot of her own energy. RIP ostrich. So that's it for this lecture. I'm gonna put up a couple different slides of a lot of the vocabulary I went over. Some things I didn't go over, but it's just nice to have them in case you like to take a lot of vocabulary notes. So this is one page. Go ahead and pause the video if you want. This is another page of a lot of the vocab we went over: consumers, tertiary consumer, all that good stuff. Here's one more. And here's the last one. So thank you for watching. I hope you learned something about how ecosystems work, how energy moves through an ecosystem, and I hope you learned that Miss Kennedy has the best music taste. Okay, bye.